I'll be inside in a minute. I'm gonna say hey to Joe. Hey, Joe.
Hey, Mike.
Flower beds are looking good, neighbor.
Yep. You guys just get back from church?
Ah, yeah, I just been at the church house.
I wonder why he never invites me to church. I mean, I'd go if he asked me to go. But this is the way it is. I'm out in my front yard when he comes home from church. It's always so awkward.
It's so awkward. And I'm so hungry. Ugh. I think my wife made goulash. I love goulash. Oh, maybe Joe would like some goulash for lunch. Hey, Joe.
Here comes the invitation to church.
Yeah?
You wanna come over
for goulash? Sure, I'd love to go to church with you.
What'd you just say?
What'd you say? You said something about God.
Goo. Goulash.
You're having goulash at your church?
No, at my house.
You're inviting me over for goulash?
Yeah.
Goulash. Yeah, who doesn't like goulash? I'd like some goulash. Yeah, sign me up. Goulash.
I'll check and make sure we have enough.
I see you walking away.
All right, so let's be honest this morning. How many of you ever been in a situation like that? Oh, come on. I know more of you than just five or six of you. You wanted to invite someone to church. Maybe you even wanted to share the gospel with them. You wanted to tell them what Jesus Christ has done for you. But the awkwardness of the situation intimidated you. You're overcome with nervousness, and you choose to remain silent rather than share the most valuable information that this world has ever known. I think if we're honest, all of us have probably been in that situation one or two times before. Can I be honest with you today? I've been in that situation many times. You might sit back and say, wait a second, Brian, you're a pastor. Your job is to tell people about Jesus. You're supposed to be a full-time evangelist, right? It's supposed to come easy for you. Can I make a confession today? It is really, really difficult for me as well. Now it's easy when I have my pastoral hat on, and somebody walks in my office and says, Pastor Brian, would you tell me how to be saved? At that moment, man, I can put my hat on and I can share the gospel with the best of them. But when my neighbor is over at my house helping to replace the brakes on my car, actually replacing the brakes on my car while I'm watching him, or whether I'm just one-on-one with a person and I don't have my ministerial garb on, and I'm not wearing my pastoral hat, it is very difficult for me as well. You see, even as a pastor, we have the same fears and we have the same failures that we do. We know that we should speak on God's behalf. We know that we are absolutely surrounded by tens of thousands of people who do not claim to be followers of Jesus Christ. We know that we have the answer, or better yet, Jesus has the answer to their problems. And yet, because of timidity, because of awkwardness, we remain silent. In today's passage, we see that Moses, the man that God chose to liberate the Israelites, was just like us. Sometimes we look at the Bible characters and we think, oh my word, those men or those women were perfect. I mean, they didn't struggle with anything. God told them to speak and they opened their mouth and spoke. They weren't scared. They weren't intimidated. Well, you're going to see in today's story that that's not the way that Moses was. Moses had insecurities. Moses had fears. Moses, like us, didn't want to be rejected. And those fears almost kept him from speaking out for God. Those fears almost kept him from rescuing the Israelites, redeeming the Israelites from the bondage and the slavery in which they were in. Let me pause for just a second. And you might say, well, wait a second, Brian, completely different scenario. I'm not dealing with anybody who's in bondage and who's in slavery. Let me remind you today that the people that surround us on a daily basis are in slavery and in bondage to a much cruel taskmaster than Pharaoh. And that taskmaster is sin that is completely dominating their lives. And if you and I do not share the message of redemption, the message of the gospel with them, who will? You see, quite frankly, I'll tell you in the very beginning what my goal today is. My goal today is for us to realize that just as God spoke through Moses, He is able to speak through you. Can I say that again? Just as God spoke through Moses, God is able to speak through you. You might sit back and say, hold on, Brian, I'm not eloquent. Neither was Moses. Brian, I'm not a trained pastor. Neither was Moses. I don't have the ability to convince anybody. Neither did Moses. And until Moses realized that God was just looking for a voice, someone through whom he could speak, Moses would never accomplish what God wanted him to accomplish. In last week's study, we saw how God selected Moses to be Israel's deliverer. I trust that you remember the story there in Exodus chapter 3. Moses was tending his father-in-law's sheep in the Midian wilderness when God appeared to him in a burning bush. And there God commissions Moses with a momentous task. Let me remind you what God challenged him to do. In Exodus chapter 3, in verse 10, God tells him this. He says, come, Moses, and I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. Now, I'd remind you that Moses wasn't anticipating that call. Moses wasn't expecting that call. Moses was a man that was on the run. He was a man who was terrified, that probably planned to never return to Egypt, never return to the Israelites. But at the moment that he least expected, God arrived to him and God commissioned him with an unbelievable task. And to solidify the urgency, the veracity, and the efficacy of that mission, God tells Moses his personal name. You remember the story. Moses asked him, well, if the people ask me who sent me, what name shall I give them? What is your name, God? And God tells them in Exodus chapter 3, he tells them my name, or he tells Moses, my name is I Am That I Am. And in verse 14, God tells Moses, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent you. Wow. Moses was selected. Moses was called. Moses was commissioned by God himself. Certainly, such a high calling would propel Moses to say, okay, God, I'm ready. Here am I. Send me. When do we start? God, I'm all in. When do we start, right? That's the way you would expect Moses to respond. But as we see in today's passage, that's not the way Moses responded. As a matter of fact, Moses responded very similar to the way that you and I respond on a regular basis to God calling us, commissioning us, in sending us. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Exodus chapter 4. Exodus chapter 4, we're going to walk through the first 17 verses today of Exodus chapter 4. Before we read the first verse, would you just bow your head and your heart and have a word of prayer with me? As a matter of fact, I'd ask you to kind of say a prayer in your heart today. Would you pray something like this? God, open my ears. God, open my heart. Help me to hear what you have for me today. Father, I pray that you do that for each and every one of us. Father, you know how this passage of Scripture has spoken to my heart this week. Father, you know how as pastors of HCC, we have been convicted by this passage of Scripture as we've studied it, as we've listened to you. And Father, I pray that you'd help each and every one of us. Father, whether we're seasoned believers today or whether we're new to the faith, I pray that you'd help us to have ears and hearts to hear today. And as you speak to us, help us to be willing not only to listen, but to be willing to obey. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Exodus chapter 4 and verse 1. Then Moses answered. Remember, Moses is answering God's call to his life. Go to Pharaoh. Tell them to let my people go. Here's Moses' response. Then Moses answered, but behold, they will not believe me, nor will they listen to my voice. For they will say, the Lord didn't appear to you. Here in the passage, if you're following along in your outline, we've simply listed that as Moses' first objection. God called him, God commissioned him, God told him what that plan was, and Moses objected. Moses had an excuse. And the excuse, very simply, that we wrote in your notes is this: God, they will not believe me. Actually, Moses makes three negative statements about how he believes the Israelites will respond there in verse 1. He said, first of all, they won't believe me. Secondly, he says, they won't listen to me. And thirdly, he says, why, they probably will mock me. They probably will make fun of me. They'll say, the Lord didn't speak to you. Now think with me this morning, humanly speaking, there was some validity to Moses' objection. Why would the Israelites believe him? After all, he really wasn't one of them. Biologically, he was an Israelite, but he had been raised in the Egyptian palace. And then when he turned 40 years old, you know the story, he killed an Egyptian, and then he fled for his life. And he's been a man on the run in the Midian wilderness for another 40 years. He really had never identified with his own people, the Israelites. Why then, why in the world would God speak through him? Why would God send him back to the Israelites? Why would they believe him? From a human point of view, there's some validity to what Moses was saying. Now, think with me, though. There are two flaws to Moses' way of thinking. And you and I are equally guilty of committing these flaws at times. The first flaw, if you're following along in your notes, is this. Moses trusted in his own ability to convince them. Notice what he said. God, they won't believe. What's the pronoun that he uses? They won't believe me. God, they won't listen to me. God, I don't have the ability to convince them. As we'll see in just a few minutes, Moses did not have the relational or the oratory skills necessary to convince God's people to follow his lead. As a matter of fact, if Moses had to persuade them to follow him, why he and the Israelites were in big trouble. Can you relate to that objection today? I'm sure most of us can relate to that objection today. The great majority of us here this morning are not public speakers. If I put a microphone in front of your face today, you probably would shrivel up. The great majority of people are not public speakers. The great majority of people are not debaters. The great majority of people are not theologians, nor are we overly persuasive. The ability to convince others is not in our tool belts. And so, like Moses, we sit back often and say, okay, God, I understand that people need to be convinced, but I don't think I'm your man. I don't think I'm your woman. I don't have the ability to convince them. That's what Moses was saying in the passage. He had a second flaw, though. His second flaw, though, was that he failed to remember that God was with him. I find it interesting how quickly we forget the promises of God. Remember what had taken place in just the previous chapter? He had this unbelievable, dynamic, miraculous experience with God. He spoke to God face to face. The angel of the Lord, a Christophany, Jesus in the Old Testament, appears to Moses, and he has a conversation with Moses, and he says, Moses, my name is I Am That I Am. I am sending you. And not only am I sending you, but Moses, I am going with you. You will not be alone. I'm not sending you by yourself. God would be with him each and every step of the way. Yet very quickly, Moses forgot that promise. So Moses' first objection is, God, they will not believe me. How does the Lord respond to Moses? Let's keep reading in verse 2. The Lord said to him, what is that in your hand, Moses? Moses said, a staff. It was a rod. It was a stick, a large stick. And God tells him, throw it on the ground. So Moses throws it on the ground, and it becomes a serpent. And he ran from it. But the Lord said to Moses, put out your hand and catch it by the tail. So he put out his hand and caught it, and it became a staff in his hand again. Notice verse 5. God says, why did he do that? That they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. Verse 6, again, the Lord said to him, put your hand inside your cloak. Put your hand inside your jacket. And he put his hand inside his cloak. And when he took it out, behold, the hand was leprous like snow. Then God says, put your hand back inside your cloak. So he put his hand back inside his cloak, and when he took it out, behold, it was restored like the rest of his flesh. If they will not believe you, God said, or listen to the first sign, they may believe the latter or the second sign. But if they will not believe even these two signs, or listen to your voice, you shall take some water from the Nile River, and pour it on the dry ground, and the water that you shall take from the Nile will become blood on dry ground. So follow what's taking place. God calls Moses to be his representative. Moses objects. God, they won't believe me. They won't listen to me. God, they're going to make fun of me. And here's what God says, here's how God responds. God says this, and it's the second point in your outline. God says this, only my power, only God's power can overcome unbelief. You see, Moses was right. Moses couldn't convince the Israelites to jump on the bandwagon and follow him. Only God could. And only God can change hearts. So God gives Moses three signs to show Moses and to show the Israelites that God was with him. First of all, He tells him to throw his staff, to throw his rod, to throw his stick on the ground. The staff immediately becomes a serpent. I love Moses' response. He is so much like me, it's unbelievable. What did Moses do? He threw it to the ground, it becomes a serpent. What's he do? He turns and runs the other way. This was a smart man, all right? He turns and runs the other way. I mean, what a normal response. He was scared of the snake. Who isn't scared of a snake? I'm terrified of snakes. We have a snake in our house. Vicky is going to get the snake, all right? He runs from the snake. God then tells Moses, he says, Moses, bend down and pick it up. Now, it's really interesting what he tells him. He doesn't tell him to pick it up by the neck, which is how you would normally, they tell me, which is how you'd normally pick up a snake. I've never really picked up a snake before, but they tell me if you're going to pick up a snake, you're going to pick up a snake by the neck. God doesn't say, pick it up by the neck. He tells him, pick it up by the tail. Now you're a smart crowd. Why don't you pick up a snake by the tail? It's going to spin around and what? Bite you. But God tells him, pick it up by the tail. Can you imagine the gasp in the crowd when all of a sudden Moses reaches down to pick up the snake and everybody's like, oh my word, he's picking up the tail. And he picks up the tail and touches the tail, and what happens to the snake? It becomes a rod again. It immediately transforms back to the staff that Moses had. Now think with me. What did that demonstrate to the Israelites? And what would that demonstrate to the Egyptians? I wrote it in your notes. It demonstrated this, that God is greater than the Egyptian magicians. You see, history tells us that the Egyptian charmers could take snakes, and they could somehow manipulate those snakes and charm those snakes into stiffening in such a way that they would look like a staff. And then they would toss that snake on the ground, and that snake that looked like a staff, they would toss it on the ground, and it would become a snake. It was a magician's act. It was something that they did. But what Moses did was the opposite. Moses didn't take a snake and make it act like a staff. Moses took an inanimate staff and with God's power made it a snake. And God demonstrated that he was more powerful than the Egyptian magicians. Verse 5, God says, I'm doing this that they might believe that the Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob has appeared to you. He then tells him to do something else. He then tells him, take your hand and put it inside your cloak. He takes his hand and he puts it inside of his cloak and he pulls it out. And his hand was leprous. It was flaky. It was white as snow. Now, it might be a little difficult for us to understand today because leprosy, thankfully, is a disease that has been conquered in our generation, in our area of the world. There's certain parts of the world where it hasn't completely been conquered, but leprosy, for the most part, is not even present in the United States. But in Old Testament times, leprosy was a death sentence. There was no cure for leprosy. If you came down with leprosy, you were immediately banished from civilization and you were sent out to leprous colonies. Why? Because there was no cure for the disease that you had. So here's Moses, his hand placed inside his cloak, and he pulls it out and it's leprous. It's white as snow. Can you imagine once again the gasp of the crowd? I mean, they probably would have ran away from him. Nobody wanted to be contaminated by leprosy. And Moses, oh, wait. And he puts his hand back inside of his cloak and he pulls it out and it was restored. It was normal. It was healthy flesh once again. What was God demonstrating? God was demonstrating to Moses, to the Israelites, and to the Egyptians that he is more powerful than even an incurable disease. And by the way, let me say today that God still is more powerful than an incurable disease. Finally, Moses is instructed to take some of the water out of the Nile and to pour it on the ground. He pours it out, and the water instantly becomes blood. Once again, this would have been much more significant. Even to us, it would have been like, ooh, what a cool trick. Can you do that again? To the Israelites living in Egypt and to the Egyptians, this was extremely significant. The Nile was the source of all life in Egypt. Everybody lived along the Nile. And in their pantheistic culture, the Nile River was one of their main deities. They worshiped the Nile River. And the fact that Moses took part of their God, and he had the power to take their God and transform their God from water to blood was unbelievably significant. What did it demonstrate? It demonstrated that God was not only greater than the Egyptian magicians, he was not only greater than an incurable disease, but the I am that I am was greater than the Egyptian gods. Now follow what is taking place, because that's an awesome story, but in the context of the story, here's what's taking place. Moses has been called by God to be God's spokesperson. He refuses. God, they're not going to listen to me. And God says, listen, I know they're not going to listen to you, but let me demonstrate my power that is behind your calling. So here's what God tells Moses. Neither the Israelites nor the Egyptians would be convinced by Moses' strong words. Only God could transform their unbelief into belief. Let me state that again. Only God could transform the Israelites' unbelief into belief. That is so very significant. Only God could give them a new heart. Do you see the application? You see where I'm going this morning? Because all of us know many people who do not know Jesus Christ. They're not followers of Jesus Christ. And we sit back, we wish, we hope that they would know what we know, that they would know the Jesus that we know, that their life would be transformed like ours has been transformed. But we're incapable of sharing the gospel in such a way that they'll believe us, that they'll embrace the gospel and catch the truth. You do not have the words nor the ability to convince them. You cannot change their hearts, and neither can I. There's only one person who can change hearts, and that is God and God Almighty. And it's His power that transforms unbelief to belief. I love the words of Ezekiel in Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 26 and 27. God tells Ezekiel and the Israelites this, and He said, "And I will give you a new heart. And I will give you a new spirit that I'll put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules." God said He is the only one. He is the only cure for unbelief. Moses was so much like us, though. Because he still wasn't convinced. I mean, if I would have seen those three miracles, my staff turned into a snake, back to a staff, my hand become leprous and then whole again, my hand dipping water out of the Nile and becoming blood, if I would have seen that, man, I would think that all of a sudden I would be like, all right, God, here I am. I am your man. You use me however you want. That's not the way Moses responded, though. Moses responded similar to how you and I respond. Would you keep reading with me, verse 10? "But Moses said to the Lord, 'O Lord, I am not eloquent, either in the past or since you have spoken to your servant. But I'm slow of speech, and I'm slow of tongue.'" Some people have said that Moses stuttered. There's no evidence in the passage that he stuttered. He basically just did not believe that he had the ability to communicate. "Then the Lord said to him, Who made man's mouth? Who makes him mute or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, the Lord? Now therefore go, and I will be with your mouth and teach you what you should speak. And he said, oh my Lord, please send someone else. And God gets angry with Moses. He says, okay, your brother's coming. Your brother Aaron will be the spokesperson. I will speak to you, Moses. You will communicate that truth to Aaron. And Aaron then will communicate that truth to the Israelites and to the Egyptians. Here is Moses' second objection, and you can relate to it, and I can too. God, I'm not eloquent. God, it seems like I get my words all out of order. I want to talk for you, and all of a sudden it just seems like I'm slobbering, and the things that I want to say are the things that I don't say. Kind of like, guys, remember when you wanted to propose to your wife? Remember that you practiced that? I mean, you had it all ready to go and you wanted to propose to your wife, and all of a sudden at the very moment, what happened? Man, your mind just became like mush. And everything you wanted to say just didn't come out. I remember the very first time that I asked Vicky out. I was scared to death. This beautiful, gorgeous teenage girl, and I'm going to ask her out. And I walk up to her, whether she remembers or not, and I was so nervous. You would think that I would stand there like a gentleman and ask her out. I was so nervous. I got down on my hands like this. You remember? I got on my hands like this, and I said, Vic, would you like to go out or something? I mean, I had planned what I was going to say. It was going to be so good. And in the moment, man, my nerves got the best of me. My mind became mush. And to this day, I have no idea what she said other than she said yes, and she's Mrs. Brian Burkholder today. So evidently, it must have been extremely eloquent. You get that. You get that. Moses says, God, I'm not eloquent. Some have said that it was a psychological objection, that he was saying, God, I have this fear of public speaking. Some have said that it was an educational objection. God, I don't know whether I'm educated enough to go back and do this. Some have said that it was an age-related objection. God, I'm 80 years old. Don't you want somebody younger than me? Some have said that it was a verbal objection. Hey, God, I've been away from Egypt for 40 years. I've been speaking Midian for the last 40 years. I'm not sure I even remember how to speak Hebrew or Egyptian or whatever that is. We're not sure what his objection was based upon, but we know God's response. And notice that God quickly and strongly responds to Moses' objection with two powerful truths. First of all, he gave him a rhetorical question, and he asked Moses this: who made your mouth? Who formed your mouth? Who placed your tongue inside of your mouth? Who gave you the ability to speak? You see, here's what God is saying. God created Moses' mouth. God is telling Moses, I made your mouth. I know your mouth's strengths, and I know your mouth's weaknesses. I know what your tongue can do, and I know what your tongue can't do. Verse 11 is so powerful. I want you to see verse 11. If we can put it back up on the screen, guys, I'd appreciate it. In verse 11, it says this, then the Lord said to him, who made man's mouth? And then he asked him this question: who made him mute or deaf or seeing or blind? Is it not I, saith the Lord? Catch that. That's such a profound truth. Catch it. Don't miss it today. Here's what God is saying. I not only made your abilities, but I formed your disabilities as well. I not only gave you the capacity to do what you know how to do, but I also gave you the lack of ability to do the things that you say you can't do. Who's the one that made the mutes? Who's the one that created the deaf? Who's the one that created the blind? God answers the question, is it not I, saith the Lord? As a father of a blind, deaf, disabledly challenged little girl, you have no idea what that verse means to me. Because God not only created my two sons as perfect and wonderful as they are, but God intentionally and perfectly created our little Amber just the way she is. And just as God can use our boys' abilities, God can use Amber's disabilities. And just as God can use your abilities, God tells Moses, I can use your disabilities as well. You say you can't speak. You say you're not eloquent. You say that your tongue is all twisted inside of your mouth. I made you the way that you are. And I made you that way to use you just the way you are. Think about that today. Don't think about your strengths today. Think about your weaknesses. What are the weaknesses that you have? What are the excuses that you and I give for not stepping up to the plate and being the men and women that God desires for us to be? God, I can't do this. God, I can't speak like that person. I don't have this ability. I don't have the resources this person has. I don't. And God says, time out. I made you just the way you are. And I not only made you just the way you are, but I called you just the way you are. And I can take you just the way you are and use you for my honor and for my glory. Moses, I made your mouth. I can speak through you. But he also told him a second thing. He said, not only did he make his mouth, but as I just mentioned, he says, Moses, I am going to speak for you. Moses, I'm not looking for an orator, I'm looking for a reporter. Moses, I'm not looking for someone to write an eloquent speech. I'm just looking for someone who will stand up and report the news. I'm not looking for someone to come up with something eloquent. I'm asking you to open your mouth and I will fill it. And when you open your mouth, Moses, I will speak through you. You see, all Moses had to do was repeat what God told him to say. As we finish the chapter, as a result of Moses' hesitancy to speak, God appoints Aaron, his brother, as his spokesperson. God would speak to Moses, Moses would speak to Aaron, and Aaron would then communicate the truth to Pharaoh. But as God communicates this truth to the nation of Israel, here's what God is demonstrating to the Israelites. And here's what God is demonstrating to us. And Paul says it in his Corinthian epistles, that God rarely chooses the wise things of the world, but he often chooses the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. Why is that? So no one else can get the glory but him. So if you sit back today and say, Brian, I'm not eloquent, I'm not talented, I can't sing, I can't teach, I can't serve, I don't have this, I don't have that, I have great news for you. You're exactly who God wants. You are exactly who God wants to use, and God desires to speak through you. So I began the message today with this propositional statement, that just as God spoke through Moses, God desires to speak through you. So let me ask you a question in the few moments that I have remaining today. Why is it that those of us who have the truth of the gospel, why is it that those of us who possess the greatest news that has ever been given to mankind, why is it that those of us whose sins have been forgiven, our future is secure, our lives are being changed, why are we so hesitant to share that truth with others? You would think that that would be something that we would be telling everybody about. But the simple truth is, that is not the case. As pastors, we've been extremely convicted about this week, because as God is blessing our church, and it is blessing our church, and we have many people that continue to come to our church, and our church continues to grow, the great majority of our growth is transfer growth. You say, Brian, what does that mean? Believers that are coming from one church to our church. Very seldom do we have somebody who walks in our door that is an unbeliever, that realizes their need of Jesus Christ, confesses Christ, becomes a believer, and follows the Lord in believer's baptism. Now you might sit back and say, well, man, you pastors then better do a better job. And we admit it. We're not doing a good job of evangelism. And we have sat back and we've made a commitment that we are going to begin to have gospel conversations on a regular basis. But please hear me today. The hope of South Florida, the hope of reaching South Florida with the gospel of Jesus Christ, is not based upon whether Brian, Jose, Brad, or Mark are going to be better witnesses. If we spent all of our time witnessing, we could not reach the tens of thousands of people in our community. You might sit back and say, well, then let's start new churches. And we do need new churches, but that's not the answer. Let's call new pastors. We do need more pastors, but that's not the answer. What's the answer, Brian? The answer is the tens of thousands of believers that we already have in our churches that will sit back and realize, I have been commissioned to speak for God. And if every single one of us took that responsibility seriously, we could impact our community with the gospel. Why don't we do that? Why don't you share your faith? Why don't I share my faith? The same reasons Moses didn't share his faith. The same reason he didn't speak for God. Two reasons. Number one, we're fearful. They're not going to believe us. They're not going to listen to us. What if they make fun of us? We're fearful. And then the second reason, just like Moses, we have a lack of faith. Well, I'm going to share it, but nothing's going to happen. God, I don't have the ability to share my faith. I can't convince anybody. And you're right. You can't convince anybody, and neither can I. But when you open your mouth, and I open my mouth, and we allow God to speak through us, God can use our voice to share the gospel with someone else. So here's what I want to do in just a moment. I'm almost done. But I want to give you a real simple way to share the gospel with somebody else. As a matter of fact, if you were sitting in a restaurant and you had a napkin, here's something that you could just write on a napkin and you could share with someone else. All right, you agree with me today. We live in a broken world, do we not? We live in a broken world. We live in a world that is filled with broken relationships. We live in a world that is filled with broken lives. We live in a world that is filled with broken governments, do we not? We live in a broken world. But that's not the way that God intended it. That was not God's plan. As a matter of fact, you know what God's plan was. Because in the very beginning, God's plan or God's design, he created the world, and at the end of his creation, he sat back and figuratively crossed his arms and he said, what? Oh, that's good. That's good. God made everything perfect. And so God's plan for his creation, God's plan for your life and mine was not brokenness. God's plan for our life was what? It was for perfection. It was for harmony. It was for relationship with him. So how did we get from here, God's plan, to here? One simple word. Sin. For as by one man, sin entered into the world. And death by sin, so that death passed to all men, because all of us have sinned. Every single one of us here today are sinners. Now, you might be a better sinner than me, or I might be a better sinner than you, but we're all sinners. As a result of our sin, we're all broken. And I'll share with you today, I am a broken man. If it weren't for the gospel of Jesus Christ, I have no idea where I would be today. I am a broken man who has been rescued by Jesus Christ. And so what happens because of our brokenness, we begin to look for solutions. And so we look for solutions in our relationships. And so we have one failed relationship after another. And then we look for solutions in our career. And we never find satisfaction in our career. And so then we look for satisfaction in alcohol and drugs and all of these things. But we're never able to find the solution to our brokenness. And so we live in this broken world, not realizing that God has provided the remedy for our brokenness. And that remedy is the gospel of Jesus Christ. The fact that Jesus came and he lived the life that I could never live, that you could never live. He lived a perfect life. And he died the death that I don't have to die and that you don't have to die. And so what happens, it's only when we realize being broken is really good. You say, that's a bad thing. It's a bad thing, but it's a good thing, because when we're broken, we have nowhere else to turn but up. And we turn in our brokenness, we turn to God. And we do two things. We repent of our sins, and we, by faith, believe in Jesus Christ. You see where I'm going with this? Here's where we are. Here's where God wanted us to be. We're a long way from where God wants us to be because of the sin in our life. And the only remedy for this is the gospel. Let me pause for a second and say something really, really strong. And I don't want to hurt you or make you mad today. If I make you mad, I'd love to have a conversation with you afterward. But listen to me today. If your daddy, even though he's a good daddy, he paid for your college, he put food on your table, if your daddy does not know Jesus Christ and does not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, your daddy is going to spend eternity separated from God in hell. If your kids, even though they're great kids and they're going to college and they're gonna provide for their families, if they do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ, if they have not repented of their sins and by faith turned to Jesus, they will spend all of eternity separated from God in hell. You say, Brian, where in the world do you get that? John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody comes to the Father except by me. So listen, here's what I'm saying today. Here's what your family members, your friends, your coworkers, your neighbors need to hear. They need to hear that there's a God in heaven who loves them. A God in heaven who paid the ultimate price. He lived the life that they could never live. He died the death that they would not have to die, so that they in turn could begin to fulfill God's plan. And it's only when we embrace the gospel that we begin to what? We recuperate the life that God has for us. And when we embrace the gospel, we begin to be able to fulfill God's plan for our life. That's not complicated. We're actually in the next few weeks, or next few months, going to give a series and going to teach you exactly how to do that. But here's my point today. My point is this. Just as God spoke through Moses, God desires to speak through you. I'm not eloquent, neither was Moses. I don't have the ability to do it, neither did Moses. They won't believe me, they wouldn't believe Moses. They won't listen to me, they wouldn't listen to Moses. They're going to make fun of me, they might make fun of Moses. But just as God commissioned Moses, so he's commissioned you and me. What if we all took seriously our responsibility to be the witnesses that God has called us to be? What if we began looking for opportunities to courageously share our faith with others? What if we had gospel conversations on a regular basis? Pastor Jimmy Scroggins of the Family Church says this: gospel conversations build gospel congregations. And I long to see scores of people from our community recognize their need of Jesus Christ, and by faith and with repentance turn to Christ. How's that going to happen? Do I need to become a better preacher? Do we need to do better music? Do we need to do different props in our auditorium? None of those things are bad, but that's only going to happen when you and I realize we have been commissioned, created, and sent by God to be his mouthpiece in a lost and dying world. And when we do that, God will take our disability and it will become an ability. Paul said, when I'm weak, then I am strong. And it's at our moment of weakness that God comes in and shows his strength and his power.